Good evening, Rowan. It's the 27th of January, 2017, and it's about 7:30 p.m. And obviously, this is my usual Friday evening video to reassure you I won't be seducing any priests over the weekend, so you can relax. Because obviously, I'm saving myself for my beloved because he's so wonderful and we're made for each other. Anyway, to break off our dip into archived lunacy that you've come out with, I'm now going to be talking about some new lunacy that you came out with on the 22nd of January 2017 when you were preaching in the chapel at Clare College, Cambridge. This was after having spent the afternoon at a conference about Martin Luther. It's the 500th anniversary of the beginning of the Protestant Reformation this year, 2017. So there's a lot of events going on around Martin Luther, commemorating this, and this was one of those events. And they were imparting this wisdom about Martin Luther, who you go around quoting everywhere, or misquoting everywhere, should I say, to promote environmentalism, as I mentioned in my last video. Well, anyway, this sermon was supposed to be about Martin Luther as well, and you do mention his name a couple of times, but as usual, it's your it's your normal lunatic delusions and attempts to manipulate the outcome you want from the difficult situation that you're in at the moment. So I'm going to make two videos about this sermon. Unless something magnificent comes up in the meantime. And I can hardly wait till Sunday to make the second half because there's so much madness in it that it's really made me laugh. It's just another one of my favourite things, a bit like your Noah story. Oh, by the way, that's a photo of you there on the screen. You were speaking at Uppsala in Sweden today. At some ceremony for an honorary doctorate. I'm not too sure whether it was you getting the doctorate. I suppose it was. So there you are in Sweden. I suppose you'll have been emitting more carbon dioxide to get over there. You won't have been rowing, will you? So that's your beautiful face there on the screen in Sweden today, the 27th of January 2017. So now, without further ado, I'm going to talk about the first part of this sermon. That you gave on the 22nd of January. So here we go. So you start off by quoting a sonnet by Geoffrey Hill, and here's how you start. Dreams of hell in which the body moves, but moves to no avail. Hell, for Geoffrey Hill, is that state in which we can make no difference to ourselves. We cannot turn away from who and what we are. So I'll just say that you're talking in this sermon in the same imperious tone that I commented on in the video I'd uploaded a couple of days before this, which was about a talk that you gave at the World Economic Forum in Davos in 2010. And also, it's not quite clear who you're talking about. You're definitely not talking about Martin Luther or St. Paul, who you also refer to a few times during this sermon. You're just acting out your own lunacy. So also, because you're fixated in this very early stage of psychological development in infancy, as I've said before, you don't know where you end and where other people begin. So I think quite a lot of this is coming out in this sermon because it's not always clear who you're sniping at. And I think you're trying to compel me to do what you want, which you've done many times before, but you're actually talking about yourself a lot of times. But I'm not sure whether you realise that or not, and I'm suspecting that you don't. So when you say hell for Geoffrey Hill is that state in which we can make no difference to ourselves, we cannot turn away from who and what we are. You're talking about yourself there. You've told me repeatedly I can make no difference. There's nothing I can do. I have to get wet. Now is the time to open and all this kind of thing, and I've got no choice. So in the light of that, I'm inclined to think you're telling me that I can make no difference. But in fact, it's you who can make no difference because you're just a petulant little brat throwing a tantrum and stamping your foot and trying to get your own way. And as I've said many times, I'm not your mother. I'm not giving you what you want. So zip your trousers up and fuck off. And the second point in relation to this, I want to say that you're supposed to be talking about Martin Luther. And although you quote Geoffrey Hill and St. Paul in this sermon, you never quote, well, you quote once Martin Luther, a very small saying of Martin Luther. So it's a bit odd, really, that you're supposed to be talking about Martin Luther, yet you seem to be quoting everyone else to illustrate points that you want to make that you say are about Martin Luther. And I don't think that's really what you're talking about as usual. You're trying to manipulate the outcome that you want. So you say, that is the hell out of which Martin Luther saw his Reformation vision at its beginning. He repeatedly insisted that Christian believers needed to be familiar with the geography of hell. Now, I do know a bit about Martin Luther. I did, in fact, study Reformation history to finals, and I still remember a question, at least one question I answered on my finals paper about Martin Luther and the influence on his work of the cities and the universities. So I'm quite familiar with Martin Luther, but unfortunately, I can't remember whether he said his belief, Christian believers needed to be familiar with the geography of hell or not. And since you've got the tendency to make things up, I'm not taking it as read that he did say that just because you've said it. However, I will say that you are going to be very familiar with the geography of hell if you don't turn to Christ and repent of your sins and stop trying to bully your victims into giving you what you want. So, yes, and stop blaming your victims as well for the situation that you're in. It's your fault, the situation that you're in, and it's your fault, the situation that I'm in as well. So, you then say they needed to know what it was to be unable to move. So, you're saying that this is what Martin Luther's saying, and then you say the body moves and moves to no avail. So, you're quoting Geoffrey Hill there. To prove in inverted commas what Martin Luther says. Well, why didn't you quote Martin Luther to prove what Martin Luther says rather than some other person who wasn't even talking about Martin Luther? That's quite bizarre. It just illustrates the way that you just make things up in your head and you present evidence for the things that you're saying, which isn't even evidence, you've just made it up. Or brought in irrelevant people and subjects in order to prove your spurious points. So then you say they needed to know what it was like not to be able to shape one's life as one would wish. And so you're saying this in an imperious tone and really emphasizing it. And of course, I haven't been able to shape my life as I would wish because of all your interference and your malevolent influence in my life and on other people who you were manipulating to treat me in an evil way and to sabotage hopes that I had for my life in several areas, in fact. So I haven't been able to shape my life as I would wish, and this is because of you. Perhaps you're telling me that Martin Luther said that this was necessary. So I'm not bothered whether Martin Luther said that or not. And I'm not taking it as read that he did say that just because you said it. And also, I mean, the whole thrust of the Protestant Reformation was that the authority above all authorities is scripture. So Martin Luther didn't write any scripture, did he? So what he says doesn't have the authority of scripture, does it? Even by his own standards. So why would I be bothered what Martin Luther said about anything as if it were authoritative? Because it isn't. Even by his own measure. So then you say, to craft a soul, a mind, a heart, a personality by one's own freedom. Well, we do have an inherent soul, an inherent character, don't we? I mean, according to Christian teaching, we've got an inherent soul. So We wouldn't be crafting a soul, a mind, a heart, a personality, because this is already inherent in us. And of course, our environment and the things we're taught influence that, but that doesn't mean we don't have an inherent soul or character and our own ways of responding to our environment, does it? So, this is another example of your fixation in infancy, that you think that you're constantly being created and recreated. You've said that before as well, that God's constantly creating us, which is just complete nonsense because creation is finished according to Christian teaching. So that isn't true. So this is just, again, I think, another example of you expressing your own infantile angst. So you then say, Luther looked at himself and looked into a pit of anxiety that no action of his own could resolve. So I think you're talking about yourself there as well. Luther was quite a troubled person in his earlier years and spent a lot of time worrying about his faith and whether he was saved and all this kind of thing. So he certainly was a very anxious person. He was an Augustinian friar, a kind of monk, and in his earlier life he spent a lot of time worrying about these things. So that is true. But I think when you're talking about looking into a pit of anxiety, you're talking about yourself, which no action. Are you talking about getting some action again? Because you're not going to be getting any action, so you're right. You're right to be anxious. And you're right to believe that no action of your own is going to resolve the situation that you're in. So you then say, and it took a very long time for him to realise that there was no hope except in looking away, looking up from the abyss. So you have got no hope, you're right. You've got no hope of getting what you want out of me. But you don't seem to be looking away. In fact, the things that you're referring to here still make me think throughout this sermon that you're still thinking that you're going to manipulate the outcome that you want. So you then say, memorably, he described the average human soul as curved in on itself, incurvatus in se, we are a spiritual ingrowing toenail, each one of us. So there's a glitch in the recording in that part, in the recording that I made, I mean, not in the original recording. Well, you're certainly curved in on yourself, aren't you? I'm not too sure whether Luther said we're an ingrowing toenail or not. That might be your elaboration. Anyway, you do say that Martin Luther said things that he didn't say, don't you? So you then say, only love makes a difference, only the word that speaks to us of what we are not and from what we are not. So I hope you're not trying to present yourself as loving here because you're anything but loving. You're quite the opposite. In fact, you're a vindictive, spiteful little man. So the word that speaks to us of what we are not, well, I've told you a lot about what you are not. Like, you're not a Christian, you're not a holy person, you're not a brilliant academic, you're a madman. You're trying to make me into what I am not just to save your own skin and feed your own overinflated ego. So you then say, and yet, when that love comes to us, it can seem the most unwelcome thing in the world. We have become so accustomed to our own impotence and our own despair, and your voice wavers on despair there, so I think you're currying sympathy or attempting to curry sympathy anyway. Well, I haven't got any sympathy. I don't think you've got any sympathy for me for all the evil abuse you've put me through and had other people put me through. You don't care one iota. The only thing you care about is saving your own skin. So don't bother wavering your voice because I've got no sympathy for you. So good luck garnering sympathy from other people. I've got sympathy for all your victims. I've got sympathy for all those dead and maimed and traumatized people who've been involved in globalist wars as a result of your propaganda. And you've got enough self-pity for everyone anyway. You don't need other people to pity you because you spend so much time wallowing in self-pity and self-indulgence. And yet, when that love comes to us, it can seem the most unwelcome thing in the world. Well, you're not a loving person, and so your intrusion and interference in my life and your constant attempts to involve yourself with me when I don't want anything to do with you, that is unwelcome. But it isn't love, Rowan, it's self-indulgence, narcissism, and a petulant little brat demanding his own way. So you can go on being accustomed to your impotence, quite literally and metaphorically. So you then say, I'm so accustomed to the various fictions we tell ourselves in order to soften that unpalatable fact that when actual love comes from an actual other, we decide we don't very much want it. Thank you. So I think that you're telling me here that I'm not recognizing you as an actual other. So I've said that you don't recognize other people as being distinct entities from you. They're only ciphers, characters in your novel. So I think you're twisting this round here and saying that it's me who's doing this and that you're an actual other and that I don't recognize your actual love coming from the actual other that is you. And so that's why I've decided I don't very much want it. Well, to be honest, Rowan, it's absolutely irrelevant what I do and don't recognise about you or about other people. I have made the decision that I don't want anything to do with you. I don't want to be sexually involved with you, particularly. I don't believe that you're a loving person, and I have the right of freedom of association, and I do not wish to associate with you. So it's completely irrelevant what motivates those thoughts or decisions. You've got no right to overrule them and insist that you've got some right to be involved with me when you clearly don't. So you're talking here, we're so accustomed to the various fictions we tell ourselves. Well, I don't tell myself fictions, Rowan. You tell yourself fictions. You live in a fantasy world and you're a psychopath and a sexual predator. In order to soften that unpalatable fact, you're talking about the fact that I've said you've got a microscopic floppy thing here. And when you talk about that unpalatable fact, you're talking about oral sex, aren't you? And I'm putting a video clip in to illustrate what I think you're referring to here. When I play the clip of you saying this later on, so I won't say any more about that now. But when you say we decide we don't very much want it, thank you, I have decided I don't want you. And that's not because I'm telling myself any fictions, it's because I'm seeing you exactly as you are. And in any case, I've got the right to make any decision I want about who to associate with and not to associate with. And you've got no right to argue about it. You've got no rights over me whatsoever. So zip your trousers up and fuck off. So you then say, that's why the love of God can appear terrible. The most dangerous thing in the world, something that tears up our roots and threatens us fundamentally. So you're not really talking about God here, are you? You're talking about you, and you're saying that you're loving. You think you're God anyway, as I've talked about before in various videos, so I won't say anything more about it now. So when you're saying that's why the love of God can appear terrible, you're talking about yourself. Yes, well, there is such a thing as the love of God, but there's no such thing as love from Rowan Williams because you're a completely unloving, self-loving person. So no love comes from you to anyone else. It's all manipulation and abuse and self-interest. So don't even bother with this garbage, this manipulation, and everything you've done to try and force me to involve myself with you. So this love of God, or your so-called love, is the most dangerous thing in the world, something that tears up our roots and threatens us fundamentally. So, well, you have torn up my roots and threatened me fundamentally, haven't you? And you are a very dangerous, disturbed individual, which is what I told you in a letter I wrote to you in 2010, which I've already read out parts of on YouTube. So you then say, and so for Luther, as he fought his way towards the defining insight of the Reformation, God was a God who had to be seen at one and the same time as your worst enemy and your best friend. So you're my worst enemy, aren't you? Because you've had this vindictive hate campaign orchestrated against me for decades to try and force me to involve myself with you. So you're my worst enemy. I don't know what this nonsense is supposed to mean. Like, I can't have God unless I have you. I think that's what you're saying, and that you ought to be my best friend. Well, I don't think so, Rowan. I think you're talking yet more shit. And none of your sophistry is going to do anything to sway me at all. I'm just going to put another video on YouTube, drawing attention to the garbage that you talk. So you then say, God is the one who is determined to dismantle and discard most of what you thought was you, for the sake of a you you hardly dreamed of, a you which could rejoice, a you which could give thanks and which could be at peace. So I've dismantled and discarded most of what you thought was you, because you have this delusion that you're superior to other people, that you're some brilliant academic, you're a very holy person, you're a Christian, you're more holy and spiritual than other people, and you can explain Christian teaching better than other people, and you've got some deep insight into it, whereas in fact you just make things up which suit your own narcissistic delusions and also the globalist agenda that you're constantly promoting, and which is being dictated to you by your globalist puppet masters. So I've dismantled your public image and your self-image and discarded it. But I think you think you're dismantling me. Well, you're not dismantling me, Rowan. You wanted to dismantle me, and you did discard me as well, or you had other people discard me, because you wanted to make it seem like you were my best option. So you think you've been doing this to me. You're not dismantling me. You're just pissing me off. And I'm just telling you what a psychopathic slime ball you are. And I'm absolutely not having anything to do with you, no matter what. So once you've dismantled me, this is for the sake of a you I could hardly dream of. So you're dismantling me to help me, all this stuff you've done to me. Luther, you put me through hell, and Luther said, you know, that Christian believers had to go through hell. And so you're dismantling me so I can become a person I'd hardly dreamed of. A you which could rejoice, a you which could give thanks and which could be at peace. So you want me to thank you for all the abuse you've put me through, basically, don't you? You're a complete lunatic. You're a psychopath, and I'm not having anything to do with you. I have offered to kick you in the balls, and my offer still stands. So don't forget to tip me the wink if you're wanting me to do that. So you then say, basic to this insight, so you're calling me basic now, basic to this insight is that belief that God acts in the way that God wills, quite irrespective of what we think, expect, deserve or like. Well, you're pretty basic, aren't you, because you think with your penis, such as there is of it. So you've presented this impression of God before, that God's acting in a chaotic way and that God's actions and intentions can't be predicted or understood in any way whatsoever, which, as I've said many times, Christianity is a revealed religion. God took the initiative and revealed himself to us in salvation history, through scripture and through Christian tradition. So God isn't a chaotic person or chaotic being who just acts randomly and nobody can predict what the will of God is, because he's revealed to us some of his nature, at least a little of that we can understand, and he's revealed to us the way that he wants us to act and the attitude that we should have as well. And St. Paul did tell us in one of his letters, I can't remember which just now off the top of my head, that God isn't a God of chaos, but a God of peace. So you're making that up as well, but you've repeatedly presented God as chaotic. This is just so that you can instill in people the idea that they can't know God and they need to rely on you to be interpreting these things, and so that you can spin any yarn you like Luther saying that if he knew the world was ending tomorrow, he'd still plant a tree, misquoting him there, and then say, well, this is how God wants us to act. So you've made up this chaotic God who can't be predicted, simply so you can manipulate people into believing what you say and going along with your agenda, the globalist agenda. So you then say, when Luther talks about being justified by faith, that most famous slogan of the Reformation, he doesn't mean that what makes us holy is what we think rather than what we do, which is possibly the single greatest mistake you can make about Reformation theology. He believes that what makes us holy is nothing we do. It's God's eternal yes, it's God's promise, and God's faithfulness. So I think what here, when you're talking about God's eternal yes, God's promise, and God's faithfulness, I think you're talking about yourself here. You're saying an eternal yes to me, for which I'm supposed to be eternally grateful, I suppose. God's promise and God's faithfulness. You do see yourself as being faithful, don't you? You've been faithful to me, hounding me around the country and trying to get my knickers off, basically. So that's your idea of faithfulness, whereas in fact you're just demonstrating that you're a sexual predator who can't take no for an answer, and you're completely obsessed. You're as mad as a hatter. So you're saying that Luther says he believes what makes us holy is nothing we do. Well, it is true that we can't save ourselves by our own efforts. We can only be saved by the saving work of Christ, his death and resurrection. So we're saved by the redeeming work of Christ, and we need to turn to Christ and repent of our sins. We can't do it by our own effort because everybody has fallen short. Everybody sins and falls short of the glory of God. We're told that in the New Testament, but we can be saved by the redeeming work of Christ. So that is true. But then on the other hand, we have to cooperate with that, don't we, Rowan? So if you've decided to go in another direction, like by selling your soul to Satan and working for globalist Luciferians and trying to exterminate anyone who stands in your way, well, you're not cooperating with the redeeming work of Christ, are you? You're not allowing the Holy Spirit to work in you, to bring you closer to God and to make you more holy, that through this process of sanctification that occurs when Christians cooperate with the work of the Holy Spirit. So you're not doing that. So it's true that we can't save ourselves by our own efforts, but it doesn't mean that nothing we do makes us holy, because we need to cooperate with the work of grace in us of the Holy Spirit in order to come closer to that goal. So you're making that up again. And also, I think this is another demonstration of your Gnostic worldview, in which you believe that your true nature is separate from your evil actions, whereas in fact, Christian teaching is entirely the opposite. Jesus told us, as I've said before when I've talked about this, you shall know them by their fruit. So we can tell the character of a person by their actions and what the outcome of these actions is. And yours is creating disaster everywhere that you go, and traumatizing people and driving them to suicide, and leading to the starting of wars and the murder of innocent people. So that's your fruits, Rowan. So we know you buy those fruits. And Jesus also said that the things that make a person unclean are things that come from the heart, such as adultery, for example. So your true nature is not separate from your actions, and we can discern from your actions that you have a very corrupted, filthy nature, and it's easy to see from the way you act and the things that you say that you're not actually a Christian, you're just working for a Luciferian world takeover conspiracy. Anyway, I've been talking for quite a long time now, so I won't say any more this evening. But don't forget to be alert because I will be turning up to arrest you to make a citizen's arrest for terrorism. Oh, and I did notice on Twitter somebody said this week that you were visiting a Category A prison, so that'll be good, won't it? Because they do put terrorists in Category A prisons, don't they? So perhaps you were having a look round to see which cell you'd like. Looking at the cell walls, deciding which one you were going to put the photo of me and my beloved on, with our arms round each other, gazing adoringly at each other, with the European Union flag burning in the background outside your college in Cambridge, because I'll be having your job as well as soon as you're in prison. And then, of course, you'll need another wall there, won't you, to put your photo of President Donald Trump standing on the White House steps. And then maybe, if your burly cellmate doesn't mind, you could use another wall as well to put on a photo of your wife with her new Rastafarian lover. So so you've got all that to look forward to, but it's nice that you've been up there already this week to check it out so you can see where you'll be going very soon. So I'll certainly leave it there, but don't forget I won't be seducing any priests over the weekend. Don't forget that I'm very soon going to be in the arms of my lover, having a really good time in his arms on our bed of roses. And then, of course, there's your wife running off with a Rastafarian. So you've got all that to be pondering as you wait for me to turn up and arrest you. Hasta la próxima.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Crucified Lord, you swim upon your cross and never move. Sometimes in dreams of hell, the body moves, and moves to no avail, and is at one with that eternal loss. The beginning of one of the late Geoffrey Hill's sonnets. Great lacrimae sequence published in the 1970s. Dreams of hell in which the body moves but moves to no avail. Hell, for Geoffrey Hill, is that state in which we can make no difference to ourselves. We cannot turn away from who and what we are. That is the hell out of which Martin Luther saw his Reformation vision at its beginning. He repeatedly insisted that Christian believers needed to be familiar with the geography of hell. They needed to know what it was to be unable to move. The body moves and moves to no avail. They needed to know what it was like not to be able to shape one's life as one would wish, to craft a soul, a mind, a heart, a personality by one's own freedom. Luther looked at himself and looked into a pit of anxiety that no action of his own could resolve. And it took a very long time for him to realize that there was no hope except in looking away, looking up from the abyss. Memorably, he described the average human soul. as curved in upon itself, incurvatus in se. We are a spiritual ingrowing toenail, each one of us. Only love makes a difference. Only the word that speaks to us of what we are not and from what we are not. And yet, when that love comes to us, it can seem the most unwelcome thing in the world. We've become so accustomed to our own impotence and our own despair, and so accustomed to the various fictions we tell ourselves in order to soften that unpalatable fact. Shorty, when you dance, you got me captivated. Just by the way that you keep licking them dicks like a lips, I'm agitated, aggravated. To the point you don't suck my dick, then you're gonna get decapitated. Other words, you don't fucking give me head, then I'ma have to take it. And after taking that, I'ma catch your case. It's gonna be fascinating. This gonna say the whole rap game passed away on top of the affidavit. Graduated from master debater slash massive masturbated. We've become so accustomed to our own impotence and our own despair, and so accustomed to the various fictions we tell ourselves in order to soften that unpalatable fact, that when actual love comes from an actual other, we decide we don't very much want it, thank you. That's why the love of God can appear terrible, the most dangerous thing in the world, something that tears up our roots and threatens us fundamentally. And so for Luther, as he fought his way towards the defining insight of the Reformation, God was a God who had to be seen at one and the same time as your worst enemy and your best friend. God as the one who was determined to dismantle and discard most of what you thought was you for the sake of a you you'd hardly dreamed of. A you which could rejoice, which could give thanks, and which could be at peace. Basic to this insight is the belief that God acts in the way God wills, quite irrespective of what we think, expect, deserve, or like. When Luther talks about being justified by faith, that most famous slogan of the Reformation, he doesn't mean that what makes us holy is what we think rather than what we do, which is possibly the greatest single mistake you can make about Reformation theology. He believes that what makes us holy is nothing we do. It's God's eternal yes. It's God's promise and God's faithfulness.
Resolution to consider, and it's not too late.
It's getting late for scraping and scratching on the paper. Something's gonna give under this pressure, and the cracks are already beginning to show. It's too late. The footman memorized the number, but the prince still holds both his hands. You leave a palace for a bed set in Canterbury Tales. Canterbury Tales.
the best sex.
Adelante.
Oh, what care I for my house and my land? What care I for my money? Oh, I'd rather have a kiss from the wild gypsy's lips. I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle taggle gypsy. Oh.